Hi, I'm Scott Blumenthal. I'm a spine surgeon at the Center for Disc Replacement at Texas Back Institute. What you're going to see today is something very cutting edge in the world of surgery. One of the fastest growing surgeries in the United States and worldwide is cervical artificial disc replacement. However, in a very small number of cases, sometimes the disc will need to be changed or revised, much like we see in other joint replacements around the body, hip, knee, etc. We've just started to see this because the use of artificial discs has really gone up. Fortunately, the incidence or the chance of this happening is very small, but sometimes it needs to happen. So this is one of the first times that you will be exposed to that you'll be able to see a revision cervical artificial disc surgery. While the reason for this is not to talk about all the reasons that it might need to be changed, let's leave it to say that particularly in this case, it was more of a size mismatch, as well as the way the disc was moving wasn't suited to that particular patient. And sometimes different discs are better for different patients, and we're learning that as time goes by. The important thing is that when a disc needs to be replaced or for some reason isn't working correctly or the patient's not doing well, it does not always have to be changed to a fusion. It can be changed to another disc. And that's what we're going to demonstrate today. What we're seeing here is a standard left-sided approach, much like you would do for a non-previously operated surgery, and exposing, just beginning to see the artificial disc and just getting the exposure ready to put in our retractors. We're putting in our self-retaining retractors again, just like in a non-previously operated surgery, and this will get us our exposure so that we can do our work. And here with the self-retaining retractors in, we're getting ready to place our pins in the vertebrae above and below, which is a critical component to doing revision disc surgery. And this will be the lower pin. And here we go, placing the upper pin, and then we'll be placing the distracting device. And here we go with the first maneuver to remove the disc safely and easily, and that's to distract with the pins. And what this will allow us to do is first to take the core out, and this is the plastic or polyethylene core, and this would be removed first. And now we've got the two end plates, and the two end plates can be removed, you'll see in a moment, with a thin osteotome that just goes underneath the end plate so as not to damage the vertebral end plate, which you need to preserve to be able to do a revision disc replacement. Here we're taking out some fibrous tissue. We'll send it to pathology to examine it. And this is the maneuver to get the old end plate off. And this just allows it to be gently pushed towards the middle of this space, and there it comes out pretty easily. And we'll repeat that for the upper end plate. You'll see here, just a little tap, and that's all it really takes to loosen it. and there's the old end plate. So now we've got the empty disc space, and what happens here is we inspect the end plates to make sure that they are intact, and in this case, of course, they were. Take a little culture to send to pathology as well. And then any other fibrous tissue or normal scar tissue will just kind of clean up to make as fresh an appearance as possible. And we'll do this delicately with some curettes and pituitaries. And once we've got it all prepared, we'll irrigate with some sterile saline. Now, if you need to do more decompression or unpinching of either the spinal cord or the nerve roots, you can do it at this point also. In this situation, it wasn't necessary. There was no residual impingement of neurologic tissue, so it was just a matter of exchanging the old disc for the new one. One of the hallmarks of disc replacement is parallel distraction. So you can see here I let down the distraction, and then I'm using this intervertebral spreader, do all the work, and the pins will just kind of hold it. Then at this point they become retaining pins, not distracting pins. The distraction maneuver was with that intervertebral distractor, and now we've got a really nice situation to put in a new disc. So at this point we use a trial device to ensure the correct positioning and size. And we'll bring in X-ray to confirm all of this. And you can see there, X-rays confirming it. You can see the old disc to the right and the trial for the new disc on the left. And this particular disc requires a keel to be cut, so a short keel is going to be used here. And this is done under X-ray as well. I'm removing the keel at this point. And so we've selected the proper size disc, we've prepared the end plate as well as the keel cut. We'll irrigate a little bit more and get ready to put in the disc in final position. And here's the final disc. Again, it'll be tapped into position, and we'll bring in X-ray to confirm all of this. And we're watching it go in. And then we'll take all the other appliances out and get our final X-ray. That's what the disc looks like as it's in place. And there you can see the final position of the disc. And there's the other view. So we're very happy with that. As you can see, minimal blood loss. Pretty straightforward technique, although very meticulous. It's not too extensive, and you can see it's done through a small incision. And generally speaking, patient will go home the next day. Thanks for watching. This is Scott Blumenthal from the Center for Disc Replacement at Texas Back Institute.